Well, you may know that we are in the final weeks of a sermon series called The Language of Love, as we just saw on the screen. And this is an opportunity for us to kind of take a look at our relationships and talk about how exactly we communicate and how we show love to one another. You may have already seen, if you've been here for this series, that we really look and say that people have five main love languages through which we speak to each other. And so we've learned that those are words of affirmation, physical touch, receiving gifts, acts of service, which we'll talk about today, and quality time. And we each have one or two ways that we receive love the best, and maybe even ways that we give love the best. And as we talk about our relationships, we look at the book, The Five Love Languages, gives us a little inspiration. We do have that in the gathering space if you'd like to talk more about it at home, or you can visit our website for some more of those resources. But we do find when we read The Five Love Languages that the author Gary Chapman says that we all have love tanks. And he says that just as a car runs on gas, you and I run on love. And so if we are constantly having our love tanks filled by people showing love to us and in the love language that we speak best, then we get those love tanks filled and it makes us want to show love to others. On the flip side of that, if we don't really feel like we're receiving love from others, then it can make it difficult for us to feel like we want to show love. And when I'm talking about this, I'm not just talking about a romantic relationship, but parents with children, and even the way we relate to our friends or our coworkers, because we find that the more that we pay attention to and fill each other up, the better those relationships can get. Now, the biggest reason that our love tank might become empty is because maybe we're not speaking the language that person hears. And I experienced that a little bit recently. I was struggling in my relationship with my son because I found that we were always seeming to be pretty frustrated with one another. And I didn't really understand why, because I tell him I love him all the time. I give him lots of hugs and kisses, you know. And I found that he was asking me to do some things that were kind of frustrating for me, because I felt like I didn't understand why he wasn't taking the responsibility for doing simple things like making his breakfast in the morning. And he didn't understand why I couldn't do simple things like that for him. So I noticed that we were having this struggle, and one morning we were on the way to school, and we were having a conversation, and it hit me. Just like this cup that keeps getting poured into, I kept pouring into my son with words and with actions, the way that I was showing physical love by giving him hugs and things like that to him. But I wasn't speaking his love language, which I realized must be acts of service, because he wanted me to do all these things for him. So his cup was not getting filled, even though I kept pouring into him. And as I became more aware of this over the past few weeks, I've started to do little things for him. Yes, the things that he asks me, but I also try to look ahead and just do little things for him before he asks. And I've noticed a difference. I'm not sure if those two things are connected, but I've noticed that we haven't been arguing so much. And I also noticed that he's been saying things to me like, "Mom, you're so pretty. You have the prettiest smile and the prettiest eyes," and not even when he's trying to get something from me. So I think he knows one of my love languages is words of affirmation, and he's trying to fill up my love tank, because the more that our own love tanks are full, the more we can fill those of others. But it's also important for us to realize that just because somebody has a primary love language, that doesn't mean that that's the only love language that we have. If we go online and we take the love languages assessment, we find at the end that we'll see our results, and we see that they all land on a spectrum of things. These are my results, and you can see I have two that kind of land at the top, but the other love languages are still in there. So when I'm relating to my child or anyone else, it's important to keep in mind those love languages and be fluent in all of them so that we can speak them when they're necessary. But another thing that we need to do is to understand how to show grace when we are thinking about these relationships. You see, when we learn someone's love language, it makes them more vulnerable to us. And that's a good thing because, as the great Bob Marley says, being vulnerable is the only way to allow your heart to feel true pleasure. So we make ourselves vulnerable and we expose ourselves and open ourselves up so that we can have the fullest kind of relationships. But the flip side of that is if we look at the definition of the word vulnerable, it means capable of being physically or emotionally wounded, open to attack or damage. So one very important thing that we should consider when we're learning that other people are vulnerable to us is not only how to show love, but how not to take advantage of that knowledge when we become angry with someone. You see, if a child's love language is physical touch, then spanking that child is not only a punishment, but it can damage their love tanks. It can really injure them in a way that maybe a timeout wouldn't. Or if we say ugly words to our spouse when we're in an argument, then that can wound that person in a way that goes far beyond just the course of that one moment in time. And when someone trusts us with knowing what is most important to him or her, we have the responsibility to protect that. We have the responsibility to think about how Jesus showed us to love, which is that love is kind. And so we don't take advantage of those situations to hurt one another. I think that we all know that Jesus is the best role model when it comes to relationships. And so I started to think recently as my children and my husband and I were all taking this online love languages assessment to kind of see where we land and how we can interact with each other. I thought, I wonder how Jesus would score on the love languages assessment. Wonder what would show up for him. So I went online and I thought, how would Jesus answer these questions? Take a look.
Thank you.
I think that as we look kind of how Jesus would choose different things in the question, we probably could have guessed that acts of service would have been Jesus's love language because of the way that he lived, right? But the questions on there were more about how you receive love. And so that really started to make me think, because I think that we all know that Jesus would choose quality time, which kind of tied for first place with acts of service there. But I kind of struggled with that a little bit. You know, which one exactly is Jesus's love language? But Jesus himself even said something that made me think through this a little bit more. When he was visiting Martha and Mary, Martha was doing all the cleaning and cooking and getting ready for Jesus to come, and Mary came to Jesus and was listening to his words. And Martha said, "Lord, my sister has left me to do the work by myself. Don't you care? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but few things are needed. Really, only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken from her." So I think we all know that Jesus wants to receive quality time from us. But if we look at the way Jesus showed love, acts of service would be right up there. Pastor Dave said some things a few weeks ago that kind of helped me wrestle through this question. He said that when we're talking about Jesus, our question is relationship versus religion, being a disciple versus being a spectator, and being a follower versus being a fan. Why was Martha cleaning? Was it to show love? Well, maybe, but she seemed more concerned about being recognized for what she was doing and for getting the job done. "Lord, my sister has left me to do the work by myself. Don't you care? Tell her to help me." If Martha had been trying to express love, if her acts had been tied to relationship, to serving others, discipleship, bringing them closer to Jesus, or following, growing closer to Jesus herself, then perhaps Jesus would have responded just a little bit differently, maybe. Because you see, Jesus served by washing his disciples' feet, healing the sick, feeding the poor, preaching God's truth, praying for those in need, befriending the outcasts. And every act of service from Jesus was about showing love to others. And if we look at Jesus' last days, when the rubber kind of started to hit the road, when it really started to count, and he knew that his time was short, he revealed what was most important through his actions. He showed love by washing the disciples' feet. And like any good teacher, he was careful to check for understanding after he did that. He said, "Do you understand what I have done for them? You call me teacher and Lord. And you are right, that is what I am. I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet. So you should also wash one another's feet. I have given you an example. You should do as I have done for you. What I'm about to tell you is true. A slave is not more important than his master, and a messenger is not more important than the one who sends him. Now you know these things, so you will be blessed if you do them." Jesus was saying that we are not more important than our master, than he is. So if he shows love through acts of service, so should we. So how are we showing love to Jesus? Are we choosing religion, tying our Christianity to what church we attend or our routines or the rules that we follow, and looking sideways at the people who don't kind of follow those same rules? Or are we showing love through relationship, through deeper meaning in our time with him? Are we choosing spectatorship, watching others serve us from our comfy pews? Or are we choosing discipleship, getting up and asking how we can be the hands and feet of Jesus? Are we choosing to be a fan who wears a cross around our neck and cheers Jesus on? Are we choosing to be a follower who takes up our own cross and follows Jesus and serves God? Are we showing love in the spirit of the greatest commandment, which Jesus said in John 13? A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Jesus tells us that everyone will know we are his disciples if we love one another. Not if we say that we love one another, but if they can see it in the way that we live. A very wise unknown source said, "Preach the gospel always. Use words when necessary." Jesus said to love as he loved, as I have loved you, and as he loved was through acts of service. So I want to ask you a question. What's in your hand? As Paul began to shape the early church, he said to the Colossians, whatever you do, do it enthusiastically, as something done for the Lord and not for men. So what's in your hand? What do you enjoy holding? Is it a pen? Is it a paintbrush? Is it a whisk? Or is it a hammer? Is it a computer keyboard or an iPhone? What do you enjoy holding? And how can you use that to put a smile on someone's face? Can you write them a note or make them a handmade gift or help them with repairs or maybe even cook them a meal when they're sick to make someone smile? Those are all things that we can do to enhance our relationships and to serve others. Our four key questions at Shiloh are, how do you worship? How are you growing? How are you caring? And how are you serving? And in order for us to help each other grow in discipleship, we continually ask these questions. So, how are you serving? Not just as a committed member of Shiloh, but as a committed follower of Jesus. What's in your hand? And is it driving how you are serving the people you love and your faith community? Service has to come from the heart, or it's not a win. I've had a few conversations lately with servants who've come to me and said, I don't want to serve here. I just don't want to do it anymore. Or this is starting to feel like an obligation, so I need to step away for a little while. And we've had some conversations, and with some people, you know, the answer has been, you know what, you're right. It doesn't sound like this is what's making you happy. And with other people, we've had a conversation, and it's come up that, oh, you don't like this part of your servant role, but this part still makes you happy, so let's just customize that for you, and you get to serve in the way that you want, because that's what makes Jesus happy. Rick Warren, the author of The Purpose-Driven Life, says that God has shaped us each to certain capabilities. So we should serve based on our shape, and he has this acronym, SHAPE, which means S is for spiritual gifts, the gifts that the Holy Spirit gives us. So administration, evangelism, knowledge, leadership, compassion, teaching, encouragement, wisdom. H stands for heart, and that's the things that we desire most, the things that we dream about, the core of who we are, what makes us who we are. Abilities, your talents, your God-given talents in different areas. P is for personality. We can have two servants serving in the same role, but their different personalities really impact how that role is received. Experience is E. Experience with family, with education, our spiritual experience, and even our painful experiences. Because we know that sometimes when we go through that pain, it helps shape who we are, and we can help others, like our divorce care group that meets on Wednesday nights and is helping to form supportive relationships for people. So I want you to take a moment and think just for a second. What is your passion? What's in your hand? What do you love? Shout it out. Music. I love music too.
Helping people.
What about all my young friends? What do you love? What did you say?
Family.
What do you guys love? What do you love to do? Do you love to draw? Do you love to do art? What did you say?
Help others.
I love that. I love that that's what makes you happy. That's so great. So at Shiloh, we say that we give in a way that makes Jesus smile, right? So how can what makes us smile become the thing that makes Jesus smile? Jesus' love tank is filled when we serve out of our gifts, our passions, our love. When what's in our hand, as Paul said, is something that makes us enthusiastic. But he does make it clear that if we want to be like him, that we need to serve. In Mark 10, Jesus said, "Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be the first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as ransom for many." The reason I asked to preach this message is because acts of service is a huge area of passion for me. And it's not just because it's one of my top love languages, it's because I have a front row seat to the biggest service opportunities in the church. Children's Ministries has more opportunities to serve than any other ministry in the church. Dave told me so. So I know it must be true. But the other staff at Shiloh recently gave me a list and said that there are 52 servant opportunities per month that currently are still open for servants. We're still hoping to find someone whose passion is in that area. Now, we want you to serve from your passions, and I think that you know that. One of the reasons that we love finding people to serve alongside us, is because we get to form relationships with you. We get to deepen our discipleship with you. We get to help you find the thing that blesses you. And that blesses us too. You know, we had a meeting with the children's ministry servants yesterday. And one of the things that I heard was that they wanted to help find other servants to be on this team. When we have opportunities, they want to help find the people who will serve alongside them. And they told me that, number one, they've been blessed. Those people who've been serving for years have been blessed. Some of them have children in children's ministry, and some of them don't. Some of them serve just because they're called to that. But they said they've seen their children grow up alongside these friends that they're making at church, and they've been able to pour in to these friends, and they've been able to nurture them and see those relationships grow. But they said something to me that I hadn't even thought of, which was that they had been able to build relationships with the other servants, and that that was such a blessing to them, that they had built lifelong relationships because they've gotten to serve in God's love beside one another. And when you think about where you want to serve, we don't want you to feel nervous or intimidated. If there's something that seems like you might want to do, maybe you want to help media back there like Ryan's doing today and run the slides, but that might seem a little tricky for you. Well, we can train you. Mike Herzenberg, the great Mike Herzenberg, said, I told him I was going to quote him, said, "The staff are here to equip the congregation, and if there's something you feel passionate around, you can do it. We will equip you, and if it's not there and you can't find it, we will make that place for you so that you can serve where your passion is." Good job, Mike. So you can see, as long as we are solely consuming, if maybe we're just coming to worship and being fed in that way, which is very important, that's one of our key questions, but if that's all that we're doing, we're not living out our faith. You see, Shiloh can continue to function with the wonderful and faithful servants that we currently have in place, but when Shiloh lives into our identity of being a serving church, a serving part of this community, then we will begin to thrive. We will begin to make a difference in the community beyond the walls of Shiloh. Because we've talked about how acts of service can impact our personal relationships. And we've talked about how acts of service can function within our church community. But the one thing that makes acts of service unique as a love language is that it's really the only love language that we can show to strangers. Not many of us are going to walk up to a stranger and give them a hug or give a meaningful gift to a stranger because we don't even know what a meaningful gift to them would be. But we can serve even people that we don't know. Lately, random acts of kindness has become a very popular thing. We see people paying for people behind them in the drive-through, or maybe this afternoon you'll go out and shovel some random person's driveway. But Pastor Dave said, you know, I wonder what would happen if random acts of kindness start to become intentional acts of kindness. And so we're working on that, even with our children. Hey, children, this week, Wednesday night, come at 6:30, and we are going to do an intentional act of kindness. We're going to have a pizza party, and we are going to make these fleece blankets to the youth. Thank you, youth. They've started this idea. They're going to be doing it in February. And so on Wednesday night, we're going to make blankets for people who are homeless. Some of you just said that your passion was helping other people. So how about you come and join us on Wednesday? And we do that to help other people. And we'll have a good time doing it because we're passionate about it. You know, we have to step outside of ourselves and find ways to make other people smile, even strangers. It's no secret that our nation is experiencing a time when people can be quite polarized and even angry about where they land on different issues. And so we need to show love. What can we do to bring a smile to someone's face today? What can we do to show love the way that Jesus loved us? Our question for this year at Shiloh is, whom are you bringing to Jesus through Shiloh? Sometimes we can be just kind of comfortable where we are with people we know, services we know, ministries we know, you know. But the truth is that if we want to be disciples, making disciples, for the transformation of the world, we have to step outside, right? The name Shiloh is the place where the tent of gathering rested, the dwelling of God rested when the Israelites made it into the promised land. And it was never meant to be a permanent fixture. It was meant to be a mobile outpost that would move as it was needed. So if God is dwelling in our Shiloh, then his spirit not only dwells in this building, but it dwells in us as we leave and go spread his love into the world. And we have a responsibility to represent God to others as what God is. Love. That is our responsibility. Simply love. Not the rules that we follow, not the cross that we wear, not even the message that we preach from our lips. God is acts of love for every person of every color, every gender, every belief system, every political party. God is love. So if we are followers, we will listen to Jesus' call to serve. If we are disciples, we will be the hands and feet of Jesus in the world. And if we are in relationship with God, we will love others. All others. So what act of service will you choose to show your loved ones, your community, strangers, and even enemies that God is love? Dear Lord, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to come and be in your house and gather together in fellowship. And God, we thank you that you have chosen us to be your servants in this world. Please show us our purpose, show us our passion, and show us where we can serve you. Help us to show love to all that we know. In Jesus' name.